And welcome back. And we are moving into our second conversation for today. I am joined by Leroy Green, who has authored a book for teachers. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning and thank you for having me.
Leroy, so of course the book was launched last week. It's called From Me to You. And you are focusing specifically on your favorite area, your area of expertise, expressive arts. Tell me the impetus behind the book.
All right, what I noticed in Belize is that we don't have many local textbooks. It has always been my dream when I retired to focus on writing books to be used in schools, and I decided to start with early learners. Mm-hmm. So this first one is a handbook, not really a textbook, because even though it's not very thick.
Yeah.
And a handbook is supposed to be something that the teachers or the parents can carry around in their bag and easily find whatever they are looking for. So it's a handbook for teachers and parents of early learners. It contains poems and stories, but not just poems and stories. They have comprehension exercises after each one, because my belief is that that aspect of the child's development called critical thinking has been deficient in Belize for years. A lot of times when I was a supervisor lecturer at the University of Belize, I used to go to the schools, and even now when I visit some schools, a lot of the questions that are asked of the children are merely content or superficial questions instead of inference, application, analysis, and that kind of thing, which are the types of questions which really develop critical thinking in people. So when I decided on putting together this book, I decided to word the questions and sequence them in such a way that by the time the teacher or the parent finished going through the poem and the questions with the children, it would have motivated quite a lot of critical thinking instead of just regurgitating the content of the poem or the story.
Now, Leroy, you've been retired for a bit over 2 years, or about two
I'm
years
going
now.
For 2 years.
And before that, you were moving across the country, working with teachers specifically in preparing children in expressive arts, whether for Festival of Arts or just within their own community. What are the lessons from that experience moving countrywide that you have found that you've used as a part of a baseline for your book?
The book, or the series of books, because actually this is the first of a series.
Okay.
The two, I've already written two because I write in spurts, but I'm waiting for this one to finish before I launch the other two. But what I found out is that teachers countrywide are hungry for things like this, because they are asked to teach expressive arts, but in reality, Belize has no resource material to offer them. And I found that they don't know how to teach the arts. In some schools, I've noticed whoever it is, under the arts, they classify things like karaoke. Mm. Yeah, honestly, you check some of the report cards and so on. They have karaoke, they have karate as expressive arts. Expressive arts really are drama, dance, music, art, and creative writing. So I don't know where the notion came from that karaoke and karate are genres of the expressive arts.
Yeah.
The other thing, is also that a lot of schools think that once you teach language arts, you can teach expressive arts. While the two things are very closely combined, they're two different subjects. The expressive arts, if you notice, utilize and develop the very same skills developed in language arts, but they're not the same thing. So being able to teach language arts is not the same as being able
to teach. It's a different skill set.
Totally different, because language arts is language arts.
Yeah.
When you talk about teaching expressive arts, it's a combination of five genres: drama, dance, music, art, and creative writing.
Now, a part of the challenge I'd imagine that you have in schools is really the parents and their perception of what the time invested in education should be focusing on. In other words, you don't get a PSC grade on how well you put together presentation on stage or deliver a monologue or a poem.
No, you know, I don't think it's really the parents.
No?
Because in the Festival of Arts and so on, I'm still traveling countrywide working with respect to the Festival of Arts. a lot of parents are out there supporting them.
So they want to see them on stage.
They want to see them. Yeah. They want to see them on stage. I think the perception comes that from the authority people. Uh-huh. Because even when I was there for 11 years at the Ministry of Education as the National Coordinator for Expressive Arts, there was only 1 year that I got the real backing that I needed to carry out my job. And I was told more than once, to my face, the expressive arts is not a priority. And that was said to me more than once by officials at the Ministry of Education. So be the case that there were times when I booked the vehicle to go to PG, and there were like 45, 56 teachers waiting for myself, because it was not me alone.
Yeah.
There were four of us who used to go with cameras and different music instruments and so on. I would have teachers waiting down there on me, like 56 teachers, and I would get a call. The driver would come and say, although you booked the vehicle a month ago, it has been taken away this morning because we need to go and pick up somebody at the international airport. And I was like, picking up somebody at the airport is more important than going to give content and pedagogy in the expressive arts. And this happened repeatedly. Yeah. So you found that for a long time at the Ministry of Education, I could not complete the rounds of training the teachers. So when people ask me, and I'm going to be brutally frank here, do you miss the teacher? Do you miss the ministry? My answer is no. What I miss about the ministry is working with the teachers and the children. Missing the ministry itself, no.
Is it still the same? If I recall back on my primary school days, the teacher who you worked with for any form of expressive arts was just the one who was willing to put in the extra time. You know, I had teachers who stayed back every single day to prepare for Festival of Arts with me and pin flowers or make costumes or whatnot.
At first,
and free. It wasn't an added job, yeah.
At first, it was like that. But then as the years passed and it caught on, we noticed the ministry has something they call continuous professional development every year. Yeah. During the month of August, teachers have to go to various workshops in order to keep their teacher's license. And we found that many of the teachers, a large number, gravitated towards the expressive arts. Nice. A lot of them were displeased, though, because sometimes their teachers or managers would force them to attend other workshops which they really did not see as necessary. So the teachers, on a whole, they had gotten out of that idea of, oh, we'll just do this part-time and so on. Actually, when I left the ministry, my team and myself had just completed writing and drafting the new expressive arts curriculum, which was supposed to be launched in September of 2017. I left August of 2017. Since then, I don't know what has happened to the curriculum.
Wow. All right. So how do you communicate, just at a wider, especially since you're promoting this book for early learners? Expressive arts is not just about being good on stage show or Festival of Arts. A teacher who's well-equipped in expressive arts is better in the classroom for even other items. I mean, early learners, for example, learn through song and dance and poetry and play.
And what the expressive arts do, you mentioned play.
Yeah.
Play comes naturally to a child.
Yeah.
Play is really drama. Mm-hmm. Because a child learns by emulating, or what we call in Creole, follow foot.
Yeah.
When it's the big people do. And that's exactly what drama is all about. Just that drama is an exaggerated form of that done on the stage. Also, what it does for a person, not only a teacher, it helps them to be able to express themselves. It builds your self-confidence. It builds your eloquence. It takes away your shyness. A lot of people laugh when I tell them I'm one of the most reserved and one of the shyest people around. But when you get me on that stage, I'm a totally different person.
Yeah.
And I've seen it happen in several instances where I know that this person is shy.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get that person up on the stage, it's a totally different thing. Apart from that, it develops your language skills. Because when you read and you analyze a poem or a story, it's the same thing you have to do to a script.
Mm-hmm.
Because a play or a dramatized poem or a dramatized story is just words in black and white on a paper. Yeah. You have to read it, you have to understand it, you have to interpret it, you have to analyze it, you have to apply all of those skills to bring it to life on a stage. So yeah. It's developing the very same skills that you want to develop in language arts lessons. Yeah. As a matter of fact, it is language arts lessons, because before you get a child to dramatize a poem, you as a teacher have to teach it to that child as a language arts lesson.
Yeah.
So that he knows the theme, which is the main idea, the ambience, the feelings,
how to interpret
the characters. There is no way it is a waste of time. Yeah. I can attest to it because I have been involved in the expressive arts from age five. Mm-hmm. And without boasting, I must say that throughout my primary school, high school, and even at Belize Teachers College, I placed first in my class. Mm-hmm. So this did not take away from it at all.
So the book itself, how does it work to meet the goals that you're speaking of? What I hear from you so clearly and so passionately is that people perhaps sometimes underestimate the importance of having the skill set of teaching expressive arts. How do you capture that in this? I mean, it's an easy read, this small booklet for teachers and parents.
Okay, if you look at the first poem, it says, look.
Yeah.
It says, I'm not going to read through it, but if you look at the questions, the first one says, who are the people talking in this poem?
Yeah.
So the child has got to listen to it and determine, is this a little boy? Is this a little girl? In the language of poetry, we call it the voice. Mm-hmm. But since this book is for preschoolers, I don't have that in there because I don't want teachers to use terms that they will not understand. Yeah. So I simplified this. Then it says, the 10th question. This is the one which, one of the types which really develop inference or critical thinking.
Interpreting what the line means.
Yeah, number 10. It says, what do you think our waistlines catch dance fever mean? Mm. To come up with an answer, the children have to really think.
Yeah.
It's not there in black and white. But by the context, they can realize what it means. And many times we underestimate our 3 and 4 year olds. And I know that they can do it because I tried it out at one.
Yeah.
And the answer that the child gave me, of course it was not in proper English or anything.
Or it's simplified.
The child said to me, say, uncle, me when I wind up your waist.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Perfect answer for that kind of question to me. Right.
And you know, I think most of the times you wait till high school till you start to interpret poetry.
And that's why they find it so hard.
Yeah. So you have a list of poems and you have questions for comprehension, but you also have, and I think that's key, tips on how to dramatize the poems as well.
Yeah.
From tips on attire to how the overall presentation should look.
And even there's a section there where I did not write any exercises, mm-hmm. but there are about 5 poems and I'm challenging the teachers to use the examples of the questions that I have to create their own questions.
Okay.
Because I do not think that teachers should be spoon-fed. Mm-hmm. So after they have looked and used the ones that I have already done, mm-hmm. please, teachers who bought the book, create your own question.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And that's a great practical lesson for any other poetry they'll come across. The poems are all written by you?
Everything.
Wow. Okay, so you put a lot of work in here.
To be honest, I did it in like 4 days. Okay. Because as I said, I write in spurts.
Mm-hmm.
Something would come to me like 2:30 in the morning, mm-hmm. and I would have to get up right away and write it, because if I leave it until the morning when I normally get up, I won't remember what came into my mind. And inspiration comes to me like that. That's why I said to you, the other 2 in this series have already been written.
Is it going to be about age progression? So this is early learners, and then?
There's one similar to this, which is for middle school
and
upper school. That one features quite a few stories about Anansi and Tata Duhende.
Yeah.
The questions are harder, the pieces are longer, but the third one is really not similar to this. The third one is actually a textbook, much thicker. Half of it is drama and half is dance.
Okay, well, we'll look forward to that. But we do have an example this morning, a presentation of just how important and how you can get young children involved in the expressive arts.
And I must big up little Kayley Panton, who's here with me this morning. When Kayley attends Belize Elementary School, and from the time Kayley was about three, she's been entering the elocution contest there. And every time she goes, her mom, Jillian, calls me and says, can you write the poem for Kayley? And Kayley goes up there and she does justice and comes first.
Yeah.
The only thing is this morning, listeners and Marlene and myself, she will not be able to do it with music because she normally has bits of music to help with the ambience of the whole thing.
But
unfortunately, she'll not be able to do it that way.
And I have to big up Kayley on stage quite a few times, so I'm sure she can still deliver without that background music. So Kayley, it's your stage. Take it away.
Complexity by Leroy Green. I am the face of beauty, composed with ethnic diversity. Sewn the thread of unity, celebrating one Belizean identity. Listen, listen, hear the sound, the beat of my ancestors' drum, calling, calling, calling to my soul. I am African, strong and bold. Don't you feel it? The shifting of the undulated seas, bringing Americans Europeans even Chinese. Adventurers, conquerors, buccaneers, and serfs, all becoming one in this Belizean turf. So when I sing this song of praise, O land of the free by the Carib Sea, and this beautiful flag I raise, I do so with pride and dignity, celebrating my Belizean identity.
Straight gold if it was Festival
Definitely.
Of Arts.
Definitely. As
Thank
a matter of
you.
Fact, she comes into the festival every year, and she always walks away with a gold and is always representing her school in what we call the national festivals, where the most outstanding from each district is featured at the place. So she's no stranger to the stage. But when I was called to do this, I said, there's no better person to illustrate how poems can be dramatized than Kayley.
And the clear lessons that are in the poem, it's one way of them being able to learn new information.
It's social studies.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. It can be used to teach social studies.
All right, Leroy. Now the parents are begging, where can I get the book so that I can use it, or even the teachers as well?
Actually, at the launch on Thursday, I sold more than half.
Wow.
And so I think I have about 40-something left, because I only did 100. It was self-produced. I didn't ask for any sponsors or anything like that, even though people kept saying to me, why don't you get a sponsor? I'm a very independent person, and I don't want anybody to believe they own me.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of time when you get sponsors, that's what they feel like. So I decided to sacrifice and do it out of my own pocket.
Yeah.
I have about 40 left. I'm going to give my always depend upon Jillian.
Mm-hmm.
She is
at the Bliss.
Current secretary at the Bliss. She's going to have some there, and I have some at home. I know some of my old students in Belmopan. They called me last week and they said, please remember that a lot of your old students have children now, so when will you come to Belmopan? So I have Miss Miriam Conn at the ministry along with Miss Tanya Santos.
Okay.
They're checking what they would be best for me to come to
Belmopan.
They wanted me to come there and do a second launch. I said, no, it has already been launched.
Yeah.
What I can come and do is an autograph signing, but yeah. not a launch. So I don't have many, but I have at home.
That's going to go so quickly. So you can get it from Jillian at the Bliss, or they can contact you directly.
Yes.
How do they get in touch with you?
633-4590. Okay. And if they don't meet me home, I am always at number 13 St. Thomas Street, which is Mother Nature's camp.
Because that's the other phase of your life that has already started.
So if I'm not home, I'm at Mother Nature's camp, or they'll know where to send you to find me, all right? Because there's only three places I'm normally at. If I'm not at the Bliss, I'm at home, or I'm at Mother Nature's camp. And it's $20 a copy. The money from this, I'm putting aside to produce the other one.
Well, Leroy, thank you so much for coming in and telling us about your book. We really hope that people will find you and be able to get a copy for themselves, and we look forward to even more being published.
Actually, I had to laugh because I didn't expect this to happen. People are finding me from the States. I have some people sending me payment for the book through MoneyGram and Western Union. I've got to go today.
Because they're all Belizean poems too. That's the part I didn't mention. Yes. They're all, some are in Creole and some just reference or Belizean identity. Awesome. Yeah. Thank you so much, Leroy.
Thank you for having me, and I want to thank Jillian and Kayley for coming.
Yes.
As soon as I called, Jillian said, no problem. So thanks a lot. And to all the people who helped me, you had at the launch, you had the Honorable Francis Fonseca. He donated all the refreshments for the people who were there at the launch. I'd like to thank Angela's Press. I don't know who was the person who did this.
The graphic.
But I asked for the concept that I wanted, and I said I wanted the two hands outstretched because I'm giving something, I'm giving my talents and so on. Somebody at the Angela's Press did a wonderful job, and I'd like to thank that person. Mr. Ledlon for editing, my same friend Jillian there, for putting it in the book format for me. And of course, I can't remember everybody, but thanks to all who helped me to make the first part of my dream come true.
All right. Well, thank you for coming on and telling us all about it. Best of luck. The book is called From Me to You by Leroy Green. You can pick it up from Jillian at The Bliss, or you can contact Leroy. We'll share that information on our Facebook page a bit later so that you can follow up with it. But thank you. We're going to go ahead and take a break. When we come back, we'll be talking about the upcoming Cancer Walk. So stay tuned.